Well, praise the Lord. Good morning. Welcome to Soul Harvest Church. Happy Resurrection Sunday. We're going to celebrate that Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins, rose again on the third day, and is our soon coming King. Let's praise the Lord this morning with us. Hallelujah.
Risen, He's risen. Forever glorified. Risen, He's risen, King Jesus.
Well, praise God, everybody. You know, I think we just, when we get to heaven, I know which praise team I want leading. Amen. We're going to have a great service today. You know, we call this Easter Sunday or Resurrection Sunday. And it's the day that we celebrate that Jesus Christ rose from the grave. Okay? Defied all odds. And we'll talk about that. Is Easter a holy day? Well, yes. But not in the sense where some of you might have remembered the movie The Godfather. And there was a saying in The Godfather that no Sicilian can refuse any request on the day of his daughter's wedding. All right, this isn't like The Godfather where God's going to not refuse any request because this is Easter. Okay, it's not holy in that regard. But it's holy because God, through the word of God, said, hey, there are certain times and days I want you to remember. I want you to remember and memorialize some things that have brought you to this point in your life. And today is such a day that we stop and we remember that Jesus Christ is alive, that the whole mantra of the Christian faith hinges on Resurrection Sunday. And the majority of us that are here today have made that determination in our hearts that we believe that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. Now, if you're not sure, you came to the right place, because we're going to talk about that here in just a moment in a very loving and kind way. But I want to share, before we go any further with this praise and worship service, there's a way they used to greet people in the early church. They would greet people by celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. And if we saw somebody on the street, if I was walking down and I was the first one to see you, I would yell out, "He is risen." And they would respond back, "He is risen indeed." So, ladies and gentlemen in church, he is risen.
He is
risen indeed. Well, I believe that. So let's have some awesome praise and worship today and celebrate that Jesus Christ is alive.
gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life? No, I'll never be ashamed.
Savior has come with the morning light. The lamb, the liar.
worship around your throne, all generations. All hail the one true King who reigns for eternity.
Try this again. He is risen.
He is risen.
Well, good morning, Soul Harvest Church, and welcome today. You may be seated. Those of you watching online as they're taking their seats, thank you for tuning in today from all over the world. We bless you. And if we don't get to see you in this life, we will see you in heaven. Well, welcome today. And my name is Pastor Matt Nichols. This is my lovely wife, Andrea, right here. And you're sitting in Soul Harvest Church. Welcome today to Cloverdale, Indiana, the big 46120, home of Cataract Falls and the Seabar Sea. But most importantly, I believe, Soul Harvest Church. We're so glad you're here. Hallelujah. Well, just a couple formalities today. First of all, I was greeting as many people as I could before the service, and one couple shook my hand today and said, Pastor, today marks 20 years of being a part of Soul Harvest Church, and I was so blessed. Another person right here said, Pastor, it was 5 years ago on Easter Sunday, I came into church and I gave my heart to Christ, and I've never been the same since. And we've just had other people been telling me, you know, the Lord's touching me, He's changing our family, He's helping us. And this is just a happening place. And I don't know why you ended up here today. Maybe you got drugged. Maybe you're visiting family. I don't know why. But I'm glad you're here. We're all glad you're here. And the one thing I would say, today I believe the Lord has something for you that's very special, okay? And my heart and my prayer is that every single one of us, no matter the age, the economic status, the race, the gender, anything like that, my hope and prayer today is every single person here today gets touched by Jesus Christ very personally. And if you're here today, and maybe church isn't a regular part of your life, but you're saying, you know what, I see there's some destiny for me, I see there's something here. The challenge I give everybody is give it a year. One service is great. You can change your life today. You can go from non-smoking or from smoking to non-smoking for your eternal reservation today. Hopefully you don't go the other way around. That'd be a pretty lousy message, a pretty lousy Easter service. But you know what? I want, and Jesus wants so much more for you. It's a process called discipleship, of discovering a family of believers to do life with, of discovering a purpose bigger than yourself, of learning to apply the principles of the Word of God in your life to bring victory. So welcome, everybody, to Soul Harvest Church today. Just a couple formalities. We have a finance seminar coming up on April 13th. And we're going to be going from 9 a.m. It's a Saturday from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. And we're going to be talking about breaking the cycle of paycheck to paycheck living. Breaking the cycle of paycheck to paycheck. And we would love to have you, if you say, Pastor, I need this, we would love to have you there. We've got some great speakers. It's going to be a fantastic program. Our goal is that within 5 years, there will be 30 family units that are in a much better, healthier financial position 5 years from now as a result of attending that one-day class and applying some of the principles. There's a SALT meeting tomorrow. That's for the folks that have more gray hair than me or no hair. Anyway, as the SALT, our Senior Citizens Fellowship, right here tomorrow at noon in the cafe. And there's a lot more announcements in your bulletin, but I'm just hitting the immediate ones. On April 6th, which is this upcoming Saturday, there's a fellowship for the age group of 19 to 29, married or single. We would love to see you. There's more information in the bulletin. Well, we have a praise report to share, and then we've got a couple specials from the choir. But our praise report is this. Now, if you've been coming here, you know that last week we had encouraged people to give a special offering for Passion Sunday. And we prayed vehemently last fall just to get the plan for this year for discipleship and strategy. And one of the things we felt in that strategy was we were supposed to have a one Sunday offering where we challenged people to just give an offering above their normal giving as to what God put in their heart. And our goal was to be able to pay off the church's second mortgage. So when we built this building, we were originally going to finish the balcony later. We were going to recycle old sound equipment instead of putting new sound equipment in, and the flooring was not accounted for. And so we had to take out a second mortgage to be able to do those things, and obviously we needed the balcony much sooner than we anticipated. So we challenged, our goal was to pay off the second mortgage, which was $65,000. And then we wanted to have enough, our young people group is exploding, we needed another church vehicle. We wanted to be able to at least start that process, do a couple other capital things. And so what came in, we announced on Wednesday night, we had between the donations that came in, plus the donation of a really nice church van that came in last Wednesday, our church received $102,000 in one offering. So that is amazing. Now, there might be some here today, you say, Pastor, money has always been a sticking point for me. That makes me uncomfortable. Let me share something with you. And I mean this lovingly. Here's the deal. These people did not give that for a church. They gave that for you. Amen. It was given for you. They believe in you. This was 100%. 1,000%, 1,000,000% for you, for this community, for West Central Indiana, that 100 years from now, when we're all in heaven, this place will be preaching, should Jesus tarry, that Jesus saves, Jesus heals, and Jesus delivers. So I wanted to share that praise report. So tomorrow, I got to check and make sure the bank is open tomorrow. I believe they're open tomorrow, Easter Monday. But we'll be walking in and paying off that second mortgage. Praise God. So, amen. Church, your generosity was on full display. I want to tell you a story. In 1990, this really happened. A man in Ottawa, Canada, named Danny Simpson. He was 24 years old. He decided he needed some money. So he got a gun, and he went and robbed the bank. And the bank, he got $6,000. He wasn't a very good bank robber. He got caught, arrested, convicted, and sentenced to 6 years in prison. When they discovered the pistol that he used in the armed robbery, they discovered it was a .45 caliber Colt semi-automatic made by the Ross Rifle Company in Quebec City in 1918. At the time, the pistol was valued at $100,000. The man did not know what was in his hand, and he ended up going to jail because he did not recognize the power of what was in his hand. Today, friends, very simply for our offering, I want us to recognize the value of what is in your hand. Everybody has something in their hand. And when we put what's in our hand in the hands of Almighty God, amazing things happen. And I want to give you this scripture. It's Matthew 6 and 21. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Thank you for coming today. We have some amazing choir specials for you, and then we're going to dismiss our children. And I think I've got a word that's going to bless everybody here in Jesus' name. What are you guys singing today?
Now Here.
Name Above All Names. Name Above All Names. Now Here.
Now Here.
Now Here. Is that like we call our dogs? Now Here. Right. Is that what we're doing? We're calling Chewy and Leia when they've been bad? Now Here.
No.
No.
His presence is now here.
His presence Amen. Is now. I'm glad you clarified. Thank you. You may remain sitting if you can.
Yeah.
The sun was darkened and the heavens thundered, and for a moment death had thought it conquered, but it wasn't over till you said it's over. Your word is greater still. The perfect sacrifice, your body broken, as you restore to us what sin had stolen. Once and for all, you tore the veil wide open. Your power is stronger still.
All praise to the name above all names, Jesus, you reign, 'cause you're the name above all names. You turn the grave into a new beginning. Our God is risen, you're alive and breathing.
There's nothing,
that can rise against your victory. Your name is higher still.
Your name is higher.
Your name is higher still. And
you're still high and lifted.
Hallelujah. Well, thank you, choir. Thank you, praise team. At this time, we're going to keep today grades 5 through 12 in the sanctuary to be part of our main service today. But if you're a children's church age, which would be about 5 till 4th grade, we're going to dismiss you right now. We want you to head that direction. If you're up in the balcony, go down the stairs, head that direction. They're going to get you to your classroom. And parents, we just ask that you come get them after the service. Well, sure, thank you. Now, I tried something new today because you're such a tough crowd. So I went through and asked all the visitors that are here today, as many as I could find, and people who are attending for the first time, said, look, this is a tough crowd. So if I tell a joke, I need some help today. So I need you to give me a laugh today. So one afternoon, a man came home from work to find total mayhem in his house. His wife was a stay-at-home mom. And when he got there, his children were outside, still in their pajamas, playing in the mud with empty food boxes, wrappers, and trash all over the front yard. The door on the wife's car was open. There was mud all over the seats. Proceeding to go into the house, he found an even bigger mess. Lamps knocked over, throw rugs wadded up against the wall, television fallen over, food spilled everywhere, trash overflowing, broken glass, sand for no apparent reason, and the carpet. He went upstairs concerned about his wife. He stepped over toys and furniture and pillows. He slung open the door. Are you okay? And there she was in her pajamas in bed, drinking hot tea and reading a book. She smiled and looked up at him and said, how was your day, honey? He said, my day was fine. What happened here? She said, you know, all the times you come home and ask me what I did all day. She said, well, today I didn't do it. All right, come on. All right. We had a couple, I was trying to write the message, and I wanted to, thinking about something, I want to do something about the eclipse. Everybody's talking about the eclipse. Well, no, we're going to do IU versus Purdue. I thought that would get a reaction. Or we'll do March Madness. But after prayer, we're going to speak today about a wild donkey. Turn in your Bible, if you have one, to Luke chapter 19. If you have a phone, you can download the Bible app. It's very convenient. It's very helpful. The Bible app, it fits in your pocket. You can take it with you wherever you go. Luke 19, we're going to read about 7 verses of Scripture. This is about the triumphal entry. Jesus is getting ready to ride into Jerusalem, and they're going to declare he is the Messiah. This is a very special, special moment in history, the start of what's called the Passion Week. Verse 29, and it came to pass when Jesus drew near to Bethpage and Bethany on the mountain called Olivet, he called 2 of his disciples, saying, go into the village opposite you. Where you will enter, you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Loose it, bring it here, and if anyone asks you, what are you doing? You shall say to him, because the Lord has need of it. So those who were sent went their way and found it just as he had said to them. But as they were loosing the colt, the owner of it said to them, what are you loosing the colt? Why? And they said, the Lord has need of him. And they brought him to Jesus, and they threw their clothes on the colt, and they set Jesus on him. And as he went, many spread their clothes on the road. This is a supernatural account. I want to talk about, number one, this was an unbroken donkey colt. Now, if you were raised in the city, and that's okay, you would read this and just think, well, what's the big deal? But if you're a farmer, if you've ever been around animals, especially any type of four-legged beast that you would ride, a donkey, a mule, a horse, you would know that an unbroken horse, mule, or donkey would be the absolute worst thing you could try to ride. Now, young people, I'm going to take you back. I hope we don't need that. Young people, I'm going to take you back to when I was in school. Things were a little different. Everybody loves to criticize the younger generations. I think this younger generation, you're way smarter than we were. Not only do you have your iPhones and all that cool stuff, we were just too wild. Back then, we had landline phones. You had to actually pick up a phone, attach to the wall, dial a number that you looked up in a book. And I was calling a number, and it was the wrong number. No big deal. I was about to hang up the phone. I said, wait a second. Now, I was an opportunist. This girl on the other end sounds cute. So I just said, hey, you sound kind of cute. Are you cute? She said, yes, I am. I said, how old are you? And she said, 20. I said, well, I'm 18. You want to go out? And I got a date out of a wrong number. I thought that was pretty good. And we went out a few times. And my family, there was kind of a rule. And I won't go into the verbiage that my uncles taught me that can't be repeated in church. But bottom line was, if you're dating a girl more than two or three times and you don't bring her home to meet the family, there's something wrong with you or something wrong with her. So I said, I better take her back to meet the family. And back at the family farm, at that time, there was a riding where you go to take trail rides, all their horses. They were doing some remodeling on their farm, so they'd asked my grandpa to use one of his pastures for their horses. The opportunist I am, I'm thinking, ding, 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 this is going to be a great date. We're going to get a couple horses, go on a horse ride. I'm going to be a golden boy. So I go home, and I said, can we ride the horse? Sure, we'll ride the horse. I said, now be careful. There's a couple in there. There's about 25 horses. I said, but there's a couple that aren't really well-trained just yet. So you don't want to get those. I said, okay. So I went. We picked a couple horses. I said, are you the well trained? Are you the horse that's not well trained? It said, nay. So we threw, now don't laugh at that one, that was bad. We threw a couple saddles on, put our legs up and over that horse, each of us had our horse, and within 5 seconds, both of us were flat on our back, and the worst part is those horses took off for miles. And it took us hours to get them back in the pasture. I learned a lesson. Number one, I think a part of me thinks God set it up that way because he didn't want me with that girl anyway. Thank you, Jesus. But I learned a lesson. Make sure the horse is well-trained before you get on if you don't want to get thrown off. Because an unbroken horse, mule, or donkey will buck you off. If you don't believe me, go try it. You will be a believer very quickly. And Jesus says, bring me the one that's never been ridden. That describes a lot of people in our society today. We say, you know what? Ain't nobody gonna ride me. Ain't nobody gonna tell me what to do. I am my own person, and I realize even in the United States, we have a little bit of an attitude of don't tread on me. And there is part of that yes, I'm all for life and liberty, but there's also a part of that just, if we're not careful, our rebellious nature can come. If someone says stand, we sit. And every generation has a way of displaying this. In the 80s, that's when I grew up. Girls had hair up to the ceiling. It was one bottle of Aquanet per day. We had crazy, just weird fashion that made absolutely no sense. Jean jackets were okay, but Michael Jackson jackets with one glove on one hand. We were obsessed with labels, Benetton, Esprit, Swatch, and Guess. We expressed the rebellion of our culture by singing songs like Highway to Hell, You've Got to Fight for Your Right, to Party. Beat it. Pour some sugar on me. Are y'all laughing? Now, there are some of you that grew up, there's a few of you here that had a 1940 in your birth date. And you grew up in the 50s. And the way you expressed your cultural rebellion was through greasers, white t-shirts, black leather jackets, slicked back hair with axle grease, I think it was. You sang about blue suede shoes. You know, they arrested your boy Elvis for breaking cultural norms. That'll be the day. Walk the line. Shake, rattle, and roll, and tutti frutti. That's how you expressed your cultural, I'm an unbroken cult. Those of you in the 60s, God help you. Hippies, bell bottoms, long hair, beads. The drug culture became part of the American culture. The mantra, if it feels good, do it. Make love, not war. Can't get no satisfaction. Love, lost that love and feeling. Purple haze and born to be wild were the mantra of your generation. 70s, it don't get much better. The afros appeared. Disco, white dance pants. Guys who would unbutton their shirt down to here with a big old gold chain, letting all that hairy chest puff out. Staying Alive, I Will Survive, Stairway to Heaven, Lean on Me, and Bohemian Rhapsody were some of the calls of your generation to say, no one is going to ride us. There were those of you that grew up in the 90s. Fashion became a little more diverse. You had the hip hoppers, the preppers, the grungers. Parachute pants came on the scene. You can't touch this. Losing my religion, living La Vida Loca. But then we get to some of our young people. You brought us in the 2000s, you brought us low-rise jeans. You normalized yoga pants. Tube tops and puffy jackets, and you gave us such musical classics, such as Drop It Like It's Hot, Poker Face, It's Hot in Here, and my all-time favorite, Getting Jiggy With It. And our current young people, I love you so much. We took spring break last week. We went to Panama City Beach. The weather didn't cooperate. But they kept telling me, now, Pastor, I can't believe you're going to Panama City Beach on spring break. Don't you know those spring breakers are wild down there? They're wild and crazy. I said, well, I really hadn't heard. It was just, we had a place open up that we could afford to go, and that's where we went. And we went down. There was a lot of spring breakers down there. I said, well, they're wild and crazy. Let me tell you what they did. Andrew and I would take walks on the beach, and all these young people, they were doing this the whole time. I mean, for hours, we would go walk a mile one way, and they're taking selfies. And we'd walk a mile back, and they're still taking selfies. And they're creating all these poses and trying to get the sun in the background and splashing water up in the air. I'm like, no, you didn't fight for your right to party. That's what happens when you don't fight for your right. Actually, they were very quiet and respectful. Nothing like what was described. But you brought us Miley Cyrus and flowers, Bruno Mars and Mars, and Leave the Door Open. You brought us Cardi B and WAP. You brought us Taylor Swift and Ariana Grande and Lady Gaga. And bottom line is, every generation, there's nobody here who your generation did not have some type of cry. Whether you agreed with it or not, your generation tried to say, no one is going to ride us. We're different. We're not like our moms and dads. I saw a Twitter post the other day, or a twit, whatever you call it. It's X. I'm sorry. It's X. Saw an X. An X on X. And it was a young person saying, what's up with all these old people wearing Nirvana hairdo rags? Don't they have music of their own? What? Some of you don't know what I'm talking about. That's really sad. We want to say, I'm wild. No one's going to tell me what to do. Don't want to listen to no governor. Don't want to listen to no teacher. Don't want to listen to no preacher. That's what it comes down to. No one is going to control us. Number two, the master has need of the unbroken colt. Jesus said, if they ask you, what are you doing? Tell them, the master has need of it. I want you to know today, beyond a shadow of a doubt, the body of Christ needs you. Jesus not only wants you, he needs you. Jeremiah 1 and 5 says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Psalms 139 and 14 says, we were fearfully and wonderfully made. Jeremiah 29 11, one of my favorites, says, I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. 2 Timothy 1 9, you've been called with a holy calling. There's a lot of nice cars out there in that parking lot. Trucks, a lot more trucks than SUVs these days. You can have a big old GMC Yukon or big old Ford King Ranch $85,000 truck, whatever it is those things cost. And I take one little wire and disconnect it. Your truck may be very expensive. It may look good. It may have heated seats, but it ain't going nowhere. Because one wire is missing. Folks, in the body of Christ, he did not assemble us together today just so we can say, look at us, woohoo. We're here today because I believe we've been divinely tugged, divinely purposed, that the Holy Spirit has drawn us because the Lord has plans for you. The Master has need of you. You're not insignificant in any way, shape, or form. You may be the wild donkey. You may have been uncontrolled. But take it from someone who was a pretty wild donkey. The Lord has need of us. Number three, Jesus rode that colt. That was supernatural. a colt that was unbroken, untrained, never ridden. He would have bucked, kicked, rolled over, ran, did everything he could have done to get the rider off its back. And I believe that's what many of us here have been doing. Jesus has been trying to get on you, and you've been bucking and kicking and running and doing everything to say, get off my back. But I'm here to ask you today, where will you go that the love of Jesus cannot find you? Where will you go? His love will be with you in the bar. His love will be with you in the bedroom. His love will be with you in the drug house. His love will be with you in the intellectual institution. His love will be with you when you sin. His love will be with you when you run, when you hide. Wherever you go, there he is. Horses were a part of my life when I was a younger person, and to this day, I really, there's nothing in me that says, hey, I want to go get some horses. But it's a process. And when you're breaking a horse, all it is time and effort and learning to be graceful, learning that particular horse, and just getting on one more time, getting on one more time, getting on one more time. And there's you start the thing off with just putting a blanket on its back. Then you put a saddle. Just let it stay there for a while. Let that horse get used to the saddle. And at some point, you start putting a little weight on it. Horse bucks and kicks. And, of course, you've all seen the Old West movies. Some of that's real. Some of it's not. The parts where John Wayne never dies, that was real. But bottom line, you just stay with it. And that horse eventually says, you know what? Okay, you can ride me. And every now and then that horse will fight that bit in its mouth. Every now and then you get a horse that has a little more squirrely than others. Bottom line, that master, he's not going to quit. And I so encourage you today, he has need of you. And lastly, that colt carried Jesus Christ into the city. You know, it's an amazing thing when the Lord gets a hold of us that we can't help but to tell others about what he did for us. Now, from where this colt was to where they were going, it was not a 5-minute ride, it was 2 miles. This colt that had never been ridden had taken a 2-mile journey carrying the Messiah. I want to ask you folks a question. Let me ask the young people a question. How many of you on your Christmas list put, you want the newest version of the Amazon Fire Phone? Is there anybody here saying, man, I wish I had an Amazon Fire Phone? You, okay, only because of nostalgic value. Anybody here, you said, man, I just wish I had the, when is the Amazon Fire Phone bringing out a new, not a one of you wants, how many wants the newest iPhone? Yeah, if I was giving away an iPhone or a Fire Phone, what are you going to take? The iPhone, yeah. Thank you for your mass silence, I appreciate that. So, no one owns an Amazon Fire Phone today because it flopped. It came out in 2014. It was full of bugs, full of issues. It didn't do what it was supposed to do. And everybody said, we don't want this. So Amazon, one of the biggest companies in the world, who had all this money, all this research, all this development, brings out this Amazon Fire Phone, and it flops. How many here ever said, man, I just wish I had me a Ford Pinto today? The Ford Pinto came out in 1970. You could buy a new one for $2,000. The Ford Pinto had a problem. They did not properly protect the gas tank, which was located in the back of the car. So if you got rear-ended, everybody's going to die. But when Ford began to find out about this, instead of saying, hey, we have a problem, they covered it up. There was a journalist that exposed it. His name was Lee Strobel. He was an investigative journalist for the Chicago Tribune, and he's the one who broke the story. I want you to pay attention to that because that's going to come in just a few moments, Lee Strobel. But nobody's sitting here saying, hey, really wish I had me a Ford Pinto because it was a terrible car. Have you ever heard about a restaurant you can go to where they throw dinner rolls at you? How many have heard that restaurant? Lambert, yeah. You go in, you say, hey, I want another piece of bread. So raise your hand if you heard about Lambert's. Okay. Now, raise your hand if you heard about an Amazon Fire phone before today. Okay, a couple of you. All right. What if I said garlic cheeseburger? What are y'all thinking right now? How many say, let's go to Marvin's? Anybody ever heard about the hamburger joint in West Lafayette? Triple X root beer. Yeah, you've heard about it because it's good, because people tell people about it. There's nothing a Christian can do. When someone asks you to come to church, when somebody tells you about their faith, that is the greatest compliment they can pay you, because they're saying, this means so much to me, I want to share it with you. Just like we want to talk about, I went to this restaurant and they threw bread at me. Because we want to share our good experiences. This is the part of the flight where the pilot comes on and says, we're beginning our initial descent. I want to present you with three choices for Resurrection Sunday. And to help us, I want to bring in a lesson from history. There was a ship in 1739 called the HMS Wager. The ship was an English ship. England and Spain were at war. They were fighting mostly over who was going to take the territory in the New Americas, and at that time, the key battleground was the South American area. So England commissioned a fleet of 5 ships to go and engage Spanish ships and destroy at will. It was their only job. So one of those 5 ships was called the Wager. It was a warship. It was the smallest of the, there were 3 warships and 2 supply ships in this fleet. The Wager was the smallest warship. And during the initial part of the mission, typhoid broke upon all the ships. And sailors were dying left and right. And they lost captains. And so on the Wager, they put another captain in charge, and then another boat lost their captain, so they took the captain off the Wager, put him on another boat, and they had to bring up another guy named David Cheap. So he is like third string, and now he's the starting quarterback. He's in charge of this ship. And they sailed over across the Atlantic to engage Spain around South America. They stopped at Brazil, which was friendly toward the English, got some data that suggested that maybe there were some Spanish warships on the western side of South America. So they were going to take the most dangerous sailing journey known to man at that time, which was around the Cape, go through Cape Horn, South America, through what's called the Drake Passage. And when you see on the TV movies that show these giant waves and winds and storms, that is the Drake Passage 90% of the time. It's where the Pacific and the Atlantic meet. There's a lot of geographical things. It's very dangerous waters, especially at a time when they didn't have modern technology. That's the background. Here's what happens. Through the course of the storm, as they enter the Drake Passage, the wager gets separated from the rest of the boats. They don't have GPS. They don't have cell phones. Hey, where are you guys at? I'll drop you a pin. There was none of that. All it was them and the black ocean sea and wind and waves for all they could see. And they had to make a decision, choice. Are we going to continue on around the Drake Passage with a third string captain, not knowing where the rest of our crew is, and we're the smallest of the warships, so if we do engage Spain, there's a good chance we're going to get our butts kicked, but are we going to continue with the mission, or are we going to turn around and go back? That's a choice. And the young captain, who was eager to make a name for himself, said, "We're pressing on. We're going to go for it." They pressed through, and it was a disastrous journey. They did, after a few months, make it through the Drake Passage, what should have taken a few days, but because the winds and the waves are so contrary, they were basically blown to and fro the whole time, their ship taking on much damage. And by the time it's all said and done, they end up shipwrecked on a deserted place, have no idea where they were. And they're resorting to eating the last of whatever the food there is to eat. And they had to make a decision, a choice. Where are we going to go? What are we going to do? They had a couple lifeboats. There wasn't much on the island to sustain them. Even to this day, it's a very vast wasteland, southern Chile. There began to become a division. Some of the people gravitated toward David Sheep, the captain, and said, even though he's the third string captain, even though he doesn't really know what he's doing and he's made a lot of mistakes, we're bound by our duty to follow him. But then there was another man who was the most experienced sailor, the most experienced seaman, and he's the one who really knew what was happening. And some of the guys said, hey, we're going to follow this guy. And they began to divide. And they began to make plans to escape the island. And Captain Cheap said, hey, we're all going to get the lifeboats. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to get the lifeboats. We're going to sail up and around to Brazil and keep going north on the west side of South America until we find the Spanish Armada. And we're going to sneak up on them at night with the limited muskets we have. We're going to climb into their boats and take over the boat. And the men thought this was crazy. And about that time, a man by the name of Blokely, who was the one that everybody kind of respected, said, hey, I don't think that's a good idea. And they had to make a choice. Are we going to follow Blokely, or are we going to follow Cheap? And they ended up taking two lifeboats in two different directions. One went around to the west side. One went around to the east side and took on the Drake Passage again, hoping to wash on a friendly territory. And even in that, there were times they had to make choices. The ship, the little tiny boat pioneered by Blokely, they had a rowboat with it. They needed food. They were out of food. They were overcrowded. They're starving to death. Every day someone's dying. They're throwing them overboard. They sent a group of three guys with a rowboat into shore. Say, hey, go find us some food. And while they were in finding food, they lost their anchor. They weren't able to stay put. They had a choice. We can either try to navigate this, and most likely we're going to get crashed on the rocks, or we're going to have to cut sail and go and leave our three guys to perish death. It's a tough choice to make. They had to make that choice. 9/11, September 11th. When the planes hit those towers, people were trying to get out of those towers. All the power was out. It was darkness. There was darkness. You can't see. Smoke is filling. You can't use your normal route of the elevators. You have to find the stairs. And some of the stairs are blocked, some are not. And every floor, you have to make a choice. Am I going to go this way or this way? And those choices determined who lived and who died. The choices that were made on the wager determined that some people lived and some people died. Life is about choices, and sometimes the choices aren't easy, and sometimes the choices are about life and death. Amen. And I believe today, because of Resurrection Sunday, it calls for us to ask three questions. Number one, is there a God? We have to make a choice. I'm asking you to make a choice today. Is there a God? Most people here believe in God. I'm proud of you. I'm blessed by you. But let me address those that don't believe or struggle with belief for just a moment. Lee Strobel, the man who broke open the story of the Pinto, he was a devout atheist. He said, I'm going to use the same investigative journalism to go after Christianity. And as he did, this is the conclusion he came up with. To continue in atheism, I would need to believe that nothing produces everything, that non-life produces life. Randomness produces fine-tuning. Chaos produces information. Unconsciousness produces consciousness. And non-reason produces reason. I simply don't have that much faith. Amen. When I go and I see a beautiful house, my question is not, how did that house evolve? My question is, who built that house? When you see a sandcastle on the beach, you don't think to yourself, that's really neat how the wind and the waves formed randomly this beautiful sandcastle. No, when you see a castle, there was a sandcastle builder. When we see a book, there was a writer. There is no way that the ink formed by itself, the paper formed by itself, the binder binded itself, and these words and letters produced themselves perfectly in order so we could read this today. There's no chance this book or any book came together by chaos and explosion. And to believe that there is no God is to believe that this DNA system, this circulatory system, your skeletal system, your reproductive system, your digestive system, which is 10,000 times more complex than a book or a house or a sandcastle, to believe that that came from nothing, I don't have that much faith. Let me help you. Well, science. Yes, science is great. Is Pluto a planet? How many say Pluto's a planet? How many say Pluto's not a planet? How many are afraid to answer because you don't think I'm going to pick on you? For a while, if you said the Earth was round, you were a heretic. Of course, there's people still debating that today. I don't have time for you. We evolved from a single cell organism, okay? In biology today, there are single cell organisms. There is no trace of a dual cell organism. There is no trace of a tricell organism. You go from single cell organisms to very complex cell organisms. There is no in between. If there was evolution, you would be able to study a pattern. We evolved from monkeys. We have lots of monkey fossils. We have lots of human fossils. There are no in-between fossils. If for millions of years we've evolved from monkeys, there would be millions and millions and millions of in-between fossils. They found one. They call her Lucy. I've seen her. It's a joke. So if you choose to be, what am I going to do? Is there a God? Maybe you say, well, okay, I believe there's a creator, Pastor. Now, congratulations, you're now an agnostic. You've moved up. If there is a creator, my next choice I want you to make is, who is it? The Egyptians worshipped cats. And if you've ever had a cat, they act like they want to be worshipped. In Indianapolis in 2015, the first church called the First Church of Cannabis was established. They worship marijuana. In Jamaica, they worship Ra, the sun god. Other places in South America, they worship the monkey god. There's Hindus that worship all animals, but the cow is supreme. Taoism, Buddhism, Islam. How do I know that Christianity is the one? There were over 300 prophecies about Jesus Christ, starting as early as 2,000 years before he was born. People have asked me, Pastor, do you think the eclipse has prophetic significance? Yes, I do. Sure. But I don't need any more evidence. I'm convinced. Jesus is coming back soon. Let's just get ready. Jesus said there will be signs in the heavens about his coming back. I'm all for the blood moons. I'm all for the eclipse. I'm all for constellations. I'm all for all those things. I think they're wonderful. But at the end of the day, all that tells me is I need to get my butt in the book and make sure I'm prepared for Jesus to come back. There were 48 major prophecies. All prophecies in the Word of God came to pass in Jesus. Here's the odds. This was recently said by a statistician. The odds of all those prophecies over 2,000 years by different authors, by different languages, different nations they were written in, the odds of all those prophecies coming together on one man, one person at one time, were like if you were to win the Powerball lottery 22 times in a row. That is the odds of all those prophecies being filled at one time. Another statistician put it like this. It's like if you took the state of Texas, filled it 4 feet tall with poker chips, the whole state, cover it with poker chips. All the poker chips are white, one is a different color. And you would be completely blindfolded, you would have no sight, and you would say, drop me in Texas somewhere and pick out a chip. The odds are that that was the different colored chip. That's the odds of all those prophecies coming together at one time, one person. So the Bible was written by man, so were science books. The Bible spans almost 2,000 years. There were 40 authors written over three continents, three languages. Authors included shepherds, kings, scholars, fishermen, prophets, a military general, a cupbearer, and a priest all penned portions of scriptures, and yet there are no contradictions, and our science books can't determine if Pluto was a planet or not. Josephus, the historian of that day, he worked for the city of Jerusalem recording the history. And even Josephus, who was not a believer, penned in the history of Jerusalem, Jesus Christ not only existed, he was crucified, and the secular historian penned in his history of Jerusalem that indeed Jesus Christ raised from the dead. So I hope today that not only will you choose to believe that there is a God, I hope today you will choose to believe that that God is Jesus Christ. And that last choice I want to ask you today is, if you believe in Jesus, what will you do with that belief? If Jesus is God, if Jesus rose from the dead, then friends, every word in this book is true. If it's true, it tells of a literal heaven, a literal hell, and it tells that we will all stand before God to give an account for our lives. Now here's where I got to be the Pastor Matt that I am. You say, Pastor, I believe in Jesus. There are many who believe in Jesus, but I also want you to know, Satan believes in Jesus. Demons believe in Jesus, but they are lost without hope. You can believe in Jesus on a slippery slope to hell. Amen. If you're driving toward a cliff and see a sign that says, stop, turn around, the road ends, you say, I believe in that sign. I believe the road ends, but you don't turn your car around. You're going off the cliff. Amen. Pastor, I go to church. Judas went to church. He was a founding disciple in church all the time. He was the treasurer, but he was not saved. Friends, what will you do today with the reality of the resurrection? I'm not only asking you to accept the existence of Jesus Christ, but to surrender your life to him, to live for him, to become Christ-like yourself, and to allow the Master to take your unbroken colt self, and you can go King James if you want, and allow him to ride you. What will you do with that choice today? And some choices, there are life and death. And I'm sure you can find reasons to justify any decision. I read it on the internet. My friend said, my science teacher said, my dad said. But friends, when we stand before the Lord, there will be no internet, no friends, no dads. Jesus is asking us today, who do you say that I am? We're 100 feet off the ground and approaching rapidly. The date, October 8th, 1871, there was a famous preacher in Chicago named D.L. Moody. He was preaching revival, and he had the largest attendance he'd ever had. And his text for that sermon was Matthew 27:22. What then shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ? At the end of his sermon, he had the audience captivated. He left it like this. He said, I want you to take this message home and think about it. And next week when we come back, we're going to have time to dedicate your life to Christ, if you so choose. There was no next week because that night was the great Chicago fire. And all of chaos went into Chicago, and he never got to see those people in the near future. And D.L. Moody purposed in his heart at that point, he said, I will never conclude a service again where I know that I have convicted people about the knowledge of Christ without giving them the opportunity to receive Christ. And that's where we are today. Friends, choices sometimes have life and death significance. And although in 9/11, it was dark and they didn't know and they were guessing, on the wager, there was no GPS or navigation system. But today, Jesus stands here before us. And he says, here is the way. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Friends, I want to ask every head to bow and every eye to close. If you say, Pastor Matt, this is me today. I need to give my heart to Jesus Christ. And I understand that I'd love for you to have more time to think and pray and all those things, but I also understand under the urgency of D.L. Moody that there's no time like the present. If you're here today, you say, Pastor Matt, I need to give my heart to Jesus Christ. I want him to live in my heart. And I've been that unbroken donkey, and I'm ready to allow the master on my back. Would you raise your hand high enough and long enough for me to see it right now, please? Thank you there. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. There's hands all over. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. I see a bunch of you up in the balcony, too. Praise the Lord. Anybody else today? Okay. Thank you. I see you. Thank you. Thank you. I see you. And just know we're having a baptism here in a few weeks. In Acts chapter 2, they said, what must we do to be saved? And Peter said, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Repent of your sins and be baptized. And we want to give you that opportunity today. And there's something we call the sinner's prayer. It's not a magical prayer. It's not a formula or a chant. It's just us talking to God in our everyday language. That's how we pray. And I want to give you the opportunity today to pray and ask Jesus into your heart. If that's you today, I'd like the whole congregation to repeat after me for those that have raised your hand. And if you raise your hand today, I'm asking you to say this out loud so you can hear it with your own ears. Are you ready? Pray with me. Say, Dear Lord Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I believe that you are God. I surrender my life to you today. Help me to live for you. Help me to make the choices that I need to make. My old life has passed away. I'm a new creation in Christ. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we bless you and we welcome you to the family of God. Hallelujah. We bless you today. We bless you today. Now, as we dismiss, we'll have people up here. If you raise your hand, they've got information for you. They'd love to pass out, just help you take the next steps of your faith, to pray with you, and they have a gift for you. So if that's you, come on down at the end of the service. As you're leaving, I would rather your ham gets overcooked by 5 minutes than have an accident in the church parking lot on Easter Sunday. So take your time getting out of here. Watch out for the kids. Don't flip anybody off. At least wait till you get on 231. I'm kidding. It's a joke. Happy Resurrection Sunday. We love you so much. We're dismissed.